She was only probably 9 at the time. And she started like judging.
We had always taught our kids that whenever we engage a thing, we're gonna engage it wholeheartedly. We're gonna make sure that we do 150%.
Tanjum and Skip, they brought tons of people to our shows, and we enjoyed that. And we started listening to them, and one of those people that they brought to the show was Cydney.
After she started doing trophies, we noticed that she was actually able to pick out the winners of each individual classes.
Cydney is an old spirit.
She really is. She's creating a dynasty, and she's the next Arnold.
And what I've seen, seeing her grow in the profession, it just excites me.
She's not just showing you how to do this like a lot of bodybuilders do. She's showing how to do this and have fun.
So I had one coach that really, really changed my life early on and helped develop me into the woman I am today more than he actually knows.
I always try to motivate kids and try to get the best out of them.
When it gets a little too easy, I don't like that, so I intentionally put something in to make it harder.
Occasionally she did, you know, like everybody I've coached, you know, and especially the people I've been close to, at some point they go home hating me and telling their parents he's crazy.
And I just cried, and he was like, well?
What the hell is that?
Well, you done crying. Get back on the line.
The Olympia gold medal, your 2018 Bigger Olympia champion, and now two-time Olympia champion, Cydney Gillon.
All right, there it is. Cydney Gillon takes the prize here in the Bigger Olympia for the second straight year.
I'm Mark Phillips. I own Madhouse Gym in Lithia Springs, Georgia. I met Cydney about 21 years ago back at Powerhouse Gym, where I was a personal trainer. You know, at the time I was meeting her parents.
My name is Skip Gillon. I am Cydney Gillon's father.
My name is Tangela Gillon. I'm Cydney's mom. And I'm also Cydney's business manager. Most people don't know that, but I am her manager. My husband and I have been married for 32 years. We've been together 40 years.
Hi, my name is Cydney Gillon. You're a two-time Figure Olympia champion. And we're here at my favorite gym, the best gym in Georgia. I come here pretty much every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday for lower body work. I try to get some back days in here too because it has a back room that's specific to just everything back, like 20 different pieces. So I come in for that too, but I love all the leg equipment, primarily because it just gives your legs a different depth, a different shape that you can't get if you don't work out in this gym.
I'm just happy that I've known the whole family for this long and that we've been able to do this together. You know, I don't deserve any credit. It was all her. It was her will. It was what she wanted for herself, and nobody was going to stop it.
When she made it to the Olympia, it was a dream come true. But what was so special, when she actually made that top three. And I remember then, because I'm so emotional, as you can tell, and my baby became Miss Olympia. I didn't even see her face. All I remember doing is jumping up and down and running down that aisle at the arena, and my baby was Miss Olympia.
There are so many things I can say about my child. I'm very, very proud of her. She's self-driven.
I've been coming to this gym about 4 or 5 years since the original Madhouse opened. We've changed locations about 2 or 3 times now. So I've been with Mark the whole time, all the way through. Even just going back with Mark and I's history, I've been with him, known him since I was a very, very little girl, before his children were born, when his first daughter was born, like just way back. So we would come into his protein shop with my dad and my mom, And I would look around, I always get protein cookies. And then eventually he became my boss a little bit later on down the road. And then whole time we've just been friends and family, well now family, the whole time through the last 20 years. So it's just been a great ride. He's been supportive the whole way through and always making sure that I have everything that I need to keep winning titles and even win my first title. So he's always been there as a support system.
Just wanted to talk a little bit about her fitness journey that got her to those titles. In our house, there's a mantra. The mantra is excellence. We know no other way to engage things. We do everything at a very, very high level.
My father instilled in me the importance of an education. And because he did not graduate from high school, he wanted me to know the importance of excelling. And for him, it was education. And Skip and I, my husband, instilled that in our kids.
From the very beginning, her foundation includes education. Education is of paramount importance in our home. I attended Harvard, my wife attended Cornell and Columbia grad school. My oldest daughter attended Yale. Sid, of course, went to UPenn and then subsequently got a master's degree at the University of Southern California. That's just her foundation.
Once my kids were in high school, my husband and I founded Educational Innovators. We thought it was important because we instilled it in our kids, but we saw a lot of the other kids didn't have the same benefits. So we started this program back in 2010, and we have helped, oh gosh, maybe 1,000 kids plus get into school. Some kids who with 1.9 GPAs, they also got into college. So we have a 100% success rate with Educational Innovators.
My parents always instilled in me that academics are the most important. Sports are fun and all, but academics what can change your socioeconomic status, change your location, change pretty much your entire life. If you really make it work, sports can too, but you want to have something to fall back on if those sports don't work out or if you get injured. You always want to have your mind because nobody can take that from you. So that was what we were instilled. That's what we had instilled our entire lives. So going from kindergarten when there were only S's on the protocol and that was the highest grade you can get, I aimed to always have S's across the board. Conduct was a little iffy. I would get not S's, whatever the other letter was in that section, but academics are just more important to me than what you deemed I should be acting like at that age. So as I went older and I got older, academics never really left me. I always wanted to be the best. Whether that's top 10% or number one, that was always ideal. But unlike a lot of the other students I was going to school with, they did nothing but go to school. And that's been my story the whole time, all the way through college. Like you always have students who are just students. They're never student athletes or students in other clubs or students in other sororities. They're always just one thing. So that was always something that I never wanted to be. I always wanted to be multidimensional and always have my hand in different baskets and develop myself wholeheartedly and as a round individual. So yes, went through elementary school, straight A's all the time, middle school, straight A's all the time, top 10%, honor roll, all my years. High school was the same thing, top 10%. It's just what I know to do. It's strive to be the best. Give 150%. When I'm in class, I'm in class, I'm focused, and I'm doing the work I need to do. Going from high school into college was a transition, but not as much of a transition as I thought it was, because high school prepared me so much for the workload that I would have at an Ivy League institution, because I was an international baccalaureate program in high school and top 10% there. But the amount of work that you have your junior and senior year is second to none. So I got to college and I was like, oh, this is easy breezy. What all-nighters? I'm going to bed at 12 o'clock. I don't care what's not gonna be done after that. It needs to be done before 12. So that was always something that I instilled in me from high school, and knowing the stress that I'd put myself under for that amount of work, I knew that I couldn't repeat that and make it through another 4 years in undergrad. Especially running D, run track. I was a part of sorority, multiple clubs, and still doing Big Brother, Big Sister and everything like that. I couldn't really, and still working two jobs. I couldn't bring my history from high school in terms of my time management. I was good at time management then, but I had to be great now because I had six more things on my plate as opposed to the five. So I really, really worked with that and just took my time and pieced everything together, because the thing that I knew needed to happen is I needed to make money because I was paying for my education. I needed to run track and I needed to make good grades. Those three things were second to none. So whatever fell in between those cracks, it's fine, but those were my main three things. So going through that, I had to start planning my schedule, because track practice at a certain time every day. So what I would do is multitask, but at the same time, you gotta think smarter, not harder. So while everybody else was like, oh, I wanna have just one class a day, I was like, no, I'll take three classes a day, but I'm not going to school on Tuesday or Wednesday, or I'm not going to school on Thursday or Friday. So I'm making sure that my schedule only had 3 days of classwork in it, so that I had time to rest, recover, go to practice, not being stressed or rushing from class, and have time to put my work in. But it's all about having the bigger picture and seeing it fully for all the things that you need to accomplish. So all your top priorities and everything that else that just kind of falls under is kind of superfluous, just goes to the side, and you can fit it in when you can. Because granted, even though my schedule was what it was, I still was at every party, I still was at every practice, and I still got all my rest. So I lived a full life, but you have to make sure that you've planned it so that you can live that way.
Now, starting back in 1998, we engaged the Body for Life contest. We had always taught our kids that whenever we engage a thing, we're gonna engage it wholeheartedly. We're gonna make sure that we do 150%. So at that time in 1998, I was sitting at about 317 pounds. Cydney kindly informed me that I was fat.
I always say I'm an old spirit. I'm like 80 in a 26-year-old body. But I remember seeing my parents, and they just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I was looking like, and I had no filter. I didn't get a filter until maybe like high school, late high school, maybe senior year, almost college. But back then, I just looked at them in the kitchen. I was like, y'all are fat.
With that being said, I ended up having to go through and make some changes. So subsequently, for the next year, I ran about doing which is resistance training and things like that, and ended up losing 100 pounds and placing second place for my very first bodybuilding show after that time.
My husband introduced me to bodybuilding when I was 16. And it was this hardcore gym. It was like a little dungeon. But from the time I was in middle school, I loved bodybuilding. Never wanted to compete. As you can tell, I'm very shy. Never wanted to compete, especially with no clothes on in front of all these people. But when I was 38, my husband started competing, and he wanted me to compete as well. So one of the ladies that he was training, he got her to do it, but she pulled out. I'm a woman of my word. So I said, okay, let me go ahead and do it. Came in last place, was not happy. Then my competitive edge kicked in. After that, when I started competing, I was 39, 40, and I placed top three in every single show that I did. Top three. This particular show, I won Open, I won Masters, and I won overall in that show. That was in 2003, and that's when I stopped competing.
It was pretty cool seeing my parents go through their transition from that lifestyle, because they'd been healthy before, but then this is what I'd seen as I was growing up, and then they were going back into what they'd already done before I was born and as they were growing older. So it was pretty cool to see the transition and the dedication that they put into. Like, yes, they lived this lifestyle. Yes, they were really high in weight and overweight and unhealthy and stressed. That's a key thing, too. People have to relieve those stresses in order to even make these changes. So they decided to take everything into their own hands, get their grasp on it, and really just go through that journey. And it was pretty cool to see. So like, they would always include us. They have their little newspaper so you can see the date and everything. And so I would do my little bodybuilding poses and my little crab most musculars. I had no muscle at the time. I had little baby muscles. They were cute though. But it's pretty cool to like look back and see what everything looked like, because you can see like where your body is now and how it's basically the same body as it was then. Just like adult size. It's pretty cool.
Cydney, seeing this, got the fitness bug. The next thing you know, she's following us everywhere to the fitness competitions, the bodybuilding competitions. She's actually actively judging the shows and becoming more and more expert in kind of critiquing athletes on stage.
She was only probably 9 at the time, and she started like judging, you know, competitors along with the actual judges. And at the end of the shows, she was comparing her scores with the actual judges' scores, and she was spot on, you know. So we, you know, it's just part of, just been in her blood all her life, really. She just came from a bodybuilding family. Her mom and dad both competes and competitors, and just been doing it all their life.
Tangie and Skip, they brought tons of people to our shows, and we enjoyed that, and we started listening to them. And one of those people that they brought to the show was Cydney.
after she started doing trophies, we noticed that she was actually able to pick out the winners of each individual classes.
During this journey, Cydney was very inquisitive. She picked up on everything. She was really the coach, if you want to know the truth. So with that being said, what I mean by that is, you know, Tangela came to talk to Carol about.
And they asked, could she test judge for us?
She said, well, Sydney's picking the winners out every time. And Carol said, well, let's see what she has.
So we allowed her to go ahead and test judge, and she was right on spot with all the judging.
From that point, we let her be a trophy girl. So she went from trophy girl to being a test judge.
I started judging at about 10 years old. I'd been going to shows for years at that time, probably about 4 years. Since my dad started competing when I was 6, my mom came soon after him. So 4 years of just watching, and seeing what came across the stage, seeing what won, and seeing what the standard was at that time. I just grew a love for it and grew a passion for it, more so the rhinestones. That's what kind of pulled me in for the women. But even when it came to bodybuilding, women's bodybuilding, where there are no rhinestones, it's just the body. And so I came very, very concentrated on what was winning and what wasn't. And it excited me to just try and see, judge it and see if I could be the person who could determine who was gonna win and who wasn't. So I would have my little notepad, 10 years old, I'd be sketching down, I'd write the numbers, my critiques for them, whole nine, and I would show it to my parents. And then more often than not, I would always have the winners and the whole top five in line, knowing exactly where everything was supposed to go. So that was really exciting for me as a kid and a big motivation to keep coming to shows, because everybody knows most children don't have an option where they're gonna be. So if I'm gonna be there, I'm gonna make the best of it and have fun with it and see something that's gonna keep me entertained the whole time.
And then she went from being a test judge to like competing. She competed with us and we offered our first pro show in 2007. That's when she competed as the amateur, and at the amateur show, she won the entire show and turned pro.
All right, ladies, just for all the marbles. Quarter turn to your right. Quarter turn to your right. Quarter turn to your right.
At the age of 14, originally I wanted to start at 13. That's when I made my initial decision. And my mom wasn't really sure how that was gonna go, because I was a junk food junkie. I drank nothing but sweet tea. It was McDonald's all the time. Water was nowhere in sight. I was just really, really like nutritionally unhealthy. Physically you couldn't tell, but inside I had high cholesterol, the whole nine. It was not a good look. So at that time though, I decided that I was gonna change my life and like, hey, let's go ahead and do this. I wanna be serious about it. So 14 hit, and then they finally decided that I could go ahead and compete. Originally it was like, do the teen category and as a warm up, and I was like, no, it's either open or it's nothing. So I went straight in with the women, and then the first show I got last place. And I wouldn't say it was an eye opener, because I didn't have any expectations, because I didn't know what I was really getting into. I'd watched it for years, but that has nothing to do with competing. So I got up and I got, after that show, I was like, okay, how do I get better from here? So that's when I started training even more. And then I did my second show 3 months later, and that's when I won my first pro card in first place then at 14. Yeah.
And the winner of the open, of the overall polls down of the women's class is number 14, Cydney Gillon. You made it.
My name is Melissa Rosser, Melissa Dees Rosser. I got into the fitness industry. I was teaching math in Alabama, and I actually worked for a modeling agency there, and I started working out. The lady who owned the gym where I worked out was a former competitor, and she motivated me to start competing. I fell in love with the competition world. When I was competing, I met Derek. He and I got married and moved to Georgia. In the process of meeting him, however, that's when we met Skip and Tangela. They took us under their wings, and Skip started doing our diet plans, coaching us. Skip, Tan, Derek, and I, two other guys, and Cydney, who was a little girl at the time, would all load up in a van and travel the US and compete. It was fun because we would do a show. We got one hotel room. If you were competing in that show, you got a bed. If you weren't competing in that show, you got a sleeping bag on the floor.
Man, I can't miss a show. She's very superstitious about, like, hey, you know, where's Razor? That's kind of my stage name for bodybuilding. They call me Razor. And she was like, she'll send me a text, Razor, you got your ticket yet? You know? And so it's just like, we're in her room, only certain people can be there. It's like she, me, her dad and mom and Melissa, you know, and she's kind of stick to that whole little tradition of this is it, you know, nobody else allowed in my room, you know, it's after the show.
And we still follow Sydney around every show. We go to the Arnold every year, we go to the Olympia every year and support her.
So the future for me is definitely wide open. We'll see where it holds. I have my boyfriend of 4 years.
Out of just competing, I called out her mother, and her mother would just come over and say a few words to me, you did good at this show, this and that. And that kind of formed that small, that little bond. And over time, it just, it became more frequent. I always said, hey, we always talk and this and that. And then shortly after that, that was when I told her about my decision going down to doing the Miami Nationals. Little did I know, Sydney was planning to pop up and check in on me and see how I did. So that's what we fast forward back to when I went down to Nationals. And like I said, because I had nobody going, it was just me and my coach. And, next thing you know, I'm up on stage. I'm like, oh, wow, I'm in the top five. I wasn't expecting that. And I hear this loud girl just screaming in the background, like, don't let them box you in. Don't let them box you in. Open up, stay, spray open and stuff. And so I was just like, who is that? Like, call my name. And and it turned out it was Sid. And so I got fourth in that show. And eventually after the show, that was when me and her pretty much just kind of clicked. We pretty much have just been, I guess, inseparable after that.
So I had one coach that really, really changed my life early on and helped develop me into the woman I am today more than he actually knows.
I always try to motivate kids and try to get the best out of them.
When it gets a little too easy, I don't like that. So I intentionally put something in to make it harder.
Occasionally she did, like everybody I've coached, and especially people I've been close to, at some point they go home hating me and telling their parents he's crazy.
And I just cry. And he was like,
well,
what the hell is that?
When you done crying, get back on the line.
My name is Albert Thomas, and I coached in Atlanta Public Schools about 24 years. I coached both boys and girls basketball, both boys and girls track, and I also coached football.
I always see my sister. She'd run with track. She played basketball with Coach Thomas. And so I said, okay, let me go ahead and start going over to high school track practices while I'm in the eighth grade and try to see if I can get ready for ninth grade because I knew where I wanted to go and where I wanted to be. So I started coming over and training at North Atlanta High School at the time I was at Sutton.
Kids, they kind of get accustomed to you and they know what you're going to do. So when they thought they knew what I was going to do, I would change it up a little bit. I'm like, you might have thought you knew I was going to do this next, but now we're going to do something a little bit different to try to challenge you.
Every day, every tier, I got up, took my little self right on that track, and that every single day, man, there's not a practice that I went without my name being called, and I'll give you a rendition of his voice. Cydney, Cydney, Cydney. That's what he would do every day. Kid you not, I'd be clear across the track.
No, that ain't good enough, no. I want quality, but I'll take quantity.
Cydney, what the hell is that? What is that? That ain't no jaw. I'm like, coach. coach, yo, give me a break, man. And literally, but the thing is, and it's so funny now to look back and really see, like, yes, I was dying, but yes, I wasn't giving my all. So now I see what he was saying and the frustration you have when you see somebody who could have so much potential not giving 150%. So if we're running a mile warm up and I'm, look, just pussy patterning around, he's like, girl, what are you doing? So I get it now, but at the time I was like, can I just go through one practice without my name being said? Please, just one time, please. But I think he's the person who built my work ethic. Because if you're willing to, it sounds crazy, but if you're willing to go do something every single day that gives you anxiety attacks, every single day you make it through, there's nothing that can stop you after that. So every workout after that, I'm like, I already made it through the worst, I'm gonna make it through. So nothing else compares. Even when I got to high school, even when I got to college, the workouts were nowhere near as death-defying as it was with him.
The Arnold was a well-deserved win, but it's nothing like the Olympia. The Olympia, you're the best of the best. The Arnold is just another trophy, another accomplishment. But the Olympia, not many people get it. You find that a lot of people win the Arnold would never win the Olympia. Now we got both titles.
The Olympia gold medal. The check for 50.